Before we start, wow. Hey, Carly. I have a lot of candy for people, which has been my primary diet for the last several days. I just learned that John does not eat chocolate, which we will be discussing. But I hope that is not true for any of you. So I'm going to open these and then pass them around.
Why are you going to pass? Why aren't you going to throw them?
I was thinking about that, but in terms of liability.
Also, people will have to clean that up.
Right, exactly.
You should think about the people who have to clean that up.
Right.
Especially today.
So I think we have enough for like a full meal for everyone of candy.
This is all pre-show, right? The show has not started.
Okay.
We're just setting the stage.
If for some reason anyone wants vegetables.
Yeah, in my rider, which I did not realize MIT would be receiving.
Okay, so what do you want to start with?
I am supposed to receive hummus.
Pass it around.
And a plate of crudité, which I learned traveling on the road.
Was not many, sealed.
Many artist services people in theaters do not know what crudité means.
No, but we do here at MIT.
Well, I know because we live in the liberal Northeast. We're here among the elites. But out in the real world, so many young men and women would come up to me going, what's crudites? And I'm like, I'm sorry. I should have just said chopped up garbage, which is what this is. We'll pass that around, too, in case you don't like candy like me. And then I'm also supposed to have a bottle of rye whiskey. And
we'll pass
that around as well if you have ID. And I had no idea that any of this would be here, but then Seth said, do you really want all this hummus and vegetables and rye whiskey? And I'm like, oh, my instinct was to say, oh, no, that's just if I'm doing a theater show or a club show, like at 11 o'clock at night when we're going to party, the classic hummus and whiskey party. But then I was like, you know what? Actually, I do want that whiskey. It's been a hard couple of days.
I should have, if I only had asked him pre-Tuesday, then he would have said no and we would have saved some money, but.
That's true.
Unfortunately.
Well, I'll pay you back.
All right,
we're going to move this back because this is not good.
Huh? Oh. Maybe we're not.
Wow. Hang on. It may be, it's on casters. Yeah. A couple of engineers in the audience spotted that one real quick.
All right.
No, you can't move that. It's on casters. The wheels are in the wrong direction.
Here, will you bring the Jolly Ranchers up like halfway, actually?
Okay.
Bring those up somewhere around that area.
You guys amazed?
Okay.
You guys amazed I know how to do this?
We will be we'll be starting in about half an hour.
45 to 75 minutes.
Okay.
All right, Seth, watch out. Coming back.
Oh, you did it.
Boop.
Wow.
Boop. That one's giving me some trouble. There we go.
Okay. Is this, we just want to keep more space between us and the...
No, I just want to be up here. I don't want to be behind
the table. I was banking on being behind the table.
No. Got to be out there. There's an extra lav mic here in case anyone needs it. All right, now. If you don't like hummus, we also have some ranch dip. I'll open that up. Why? Are we waiting on anyone specific?
No. All right. We're just getting the Mos Eisley Tavern set up.
Well, help yourself. If you wish. Not you.
No.
Thank you, sir.
How do you do?
Oh, thank you.
Does anyone know what this is called? A dewback, yes. I thought someone was going to say a bantha, and then I could have shamed you. But a dewback. Do you know why it's called a dewback?
Just raise your hand if you want me to come to you with crudité.
Does anyone know why it's called a dewback? Oh, no.
Yeah, all right. See, all this.
In this area, please.
Everyone was being really shy until I said, raise your hand. It's like,
mm-hmm. Thank you very much.
That's right.
It is.
What do you want? Wow. Okay. Did you all get what you needed? All right. Good. Okay. Very good. Yeah. All right. What's your name?
Mara.
Mara's going to take over on the crudité.
All right, Mara.
Service.
Associate Director of the Communications Forum. Thank you very much.
Oh. Thank you very much, Mara.
I think that...
Is this the side you're going to sit on?
Unless that's your better side.
It's good. Now, we have... can everyone hear me okay? We have what are called lav mics on. It's a little peek behind the scenes of glamorous university auditorium talking. Sometimes we wear cordless mics called lav mics. This is the lav mic. This is it here. And the young man who is in the AV department here was very respectful, and he did not do what every sound person on a TV show does, which is make me hide this cord or force me to hide it by opening my shirt and running it through my shirt.
This is in case anyone didn't know John's on TV. Here we go. John Hodgman, everyone.
More premium streaming internet now, but so. Occasionally still on TV. Everyone check out Red Oaks on Amazon Prime starting tomorrow. So this will go in the back, and you're going to see some of the magic of premium streaming internet. This now goes inside my shirt, so I don't have a dumb cord hanging out like some people I know. Seth, are you going to hide your cord? Or
I am not, but I am going to ask you about the lack of undershirts, for sure.
Well, I have an answer for that.
Okay.
And it's a good one. Whenever you're ready to ask your question.
I can wait. So while John is undressing...
Well, I'm done. I'm ready to go. I'm in wardrobe. Let's go.
I will introduce this tonight. My name is Seth Manukin. I am the director of the Communications Forum. I know most of you are here to see me, and I thank you for that. I ran into, on the way over, John Hodgman, who I believe is primarily known for having been born and raised in Brookline.
How do you do?
A graduate of the Heath School?
I was an eighth grade graduate of the Heath School in Brookline, Massachusetts. And that ended my formal education.
And Brookline
then
High?
I was a shipwright, and a scrimshander, and a boat stamper, and a thing monger.
A thing monger,
yeah.
Okay. I also want to thank the DeFlores Fund for Humor, which...
yeah, me too.
Very, very generously provided the $800,000 that John requires for this event. He said that was higher because it was in his hometown.
Yeah, I don't like to come back.
And also, Chris, do we have a sign-up sheet?
Yes, right there.
Okay, so before you go, please maybe put your email on the sign-up sheet, and then you will learn about other upcoming Communications Forums events, including Aparna Nancharla, who will be here next semester, the delightful and wonderful Sarah Vowell, who will be here
Indeed.
In the spring. We got her just before the second Incredibles movie was announced, thank goodness. And many other exciting things. We will not spam you about information other than the six events we do a year, and we will not sell your email addresses asterisk unless you are a celebrity. So. Thank you all very much for coming, and should we get started?
Yes.
All right.
I'll go over here and wait for my introduction.
Okay, so, ladies and gentlemen, the host of Judge John Hodgman, is that the name of the podcast? Okay, of Judge John Hodgman. And other things, a minor television personality, a fake internet justice, a regular on the new show, John Glazer Loves Gear, And the auteur of Vacation
Land. Okay,
Currently, occurring at theaters across the country. There was an asterisk next to that that said you might want to double check if he's currently doing this. His website says he is, but there are only two more shows listed after this one, including tomorrow in Seattle. So if any of you are really dedicated fans, you will get the nigh to Seattle for tomorrow. So a big warm MIT welcome to Judge John Hodgman.
How do you do? How do you do? Can you hear me? Is this on?
Yes.
Okay, good.
I'm sorry that I messed it up. Maybe I'll just hold it. I found this hat backstage just now. And I realized I haven't had lice in a while. Maybe I should give this a try.
I actually thought, so Leslie Jones's rider, who she's also going to be here next semester.
Really?
Yeah.
Fantastic.
Stipulates that she get merch from the institute that she's performing. So I thought that perhaps that was what was going on is here as well. But
maybe I got Leslie's hat.
Now discover that you are just a hobo.
Why do you say that? Just because I made you give me whiskey and food and a hat?
Do you have your own hobo name?
Yes, it's Mr. John Hodgman.
Okay.
You're making a reference to, for those of
your
you who are
book?
Under the age of 70, you're making a reference to my first book of fake trivia, which came out 11 years ago. Can you imagine, were we ever that young? In which I listed 700 hobo nicknames, which was 699 too many.
And yet you've written books since then.
I have. Boy, this has become a real interview all of a sudden.
All right. Well, the first thing I want to ask you about, actually, is your middle name.
K.
Is Kellogg.
Kellogg,
is that correct?
That's right, yeah.
Is that due to a love of cereal?
No, it's a family name. It's
that was
family
my
name of my dad's.
Actually.
I do not believe that we are related to the Battle Creek, Michigan Kelloggs. There's no cornflake fortune for me in my future, I'm afraid. But we might, maybe, right? I can make a claim. No, I'm talking about a legal claim. The claim here means nothing. But no, that's just my middle name.
Okay, we can move on.
What's your middle name, Seth?
My middle name...
I read your Wikipedia page as well, but I didn't catch your middle name.
Did you notice the most exciting thing about me?
Well, you wrote 3 best-selling books.
No, only one, alas, bestseller. I did write 3 books.
Oh, okay, good.
Yes.
Well, that's...
So you could say best-selling author of 3 books.
Let me guess, the best-selling one was about sports?
Yes, that is true, about Boston
sports.
Yes.
About Boston sports.
And you should know that because having formerly been a literary agent,
yes,
my publisher then made, for them, the very unfortunate economic mistake of thinking that that was a bestseller due to some fault of mine, as opposed to the fact that it was about a regional sports team that is popular in New England.
I see.
And so for my next book, they let me write about whatever I wanted and then found that vaccines and autism were not as good a seller as baseball.
Not quite as mainstream appeal.
Unfortunately.
As the Boston Red Sox.
For them, yes.
Yeah.
This is going to be a full...
But Seth, that was good and important work.
Yes, thank you very much.
We don't...
The Red Sox.
Yes.
Yes.
No, the vaccine
right.
book.
Both of us have been fathers.
That's right.
And having children not inflicted with vaccine-preventable diseases.
Well, that's because I keep my children
this
in a
got,
box.
This got serious. This got serious much more quickly than I was.
No,
expecting.
I believe in. Just so it's clear, I believe in vaccines.
Unfortunately,
I believe in science. Just so you know.
That is now something up for debate, unfortunately. But we are going to wait a little bit before we get into the weepy and serious part of the conversation.
Wait a minute. I don't know why we're going to wait. I just want to know, how's everyone doing? Thumbs down up there. Thumbs down.
All right.
Thumbs down. Everyone's
feeling, a lot,
feeling bad, right? Yeah, it's terrible. I mean, I don't know. And I ask genuinely, and I'm not going to yell at anybody, is there anyone here who voted for Donald Trump? A single person in this room? I mean, statistically speaking, someone should have because you're all white. That's not true. Excuse me. I understand. I know. It was just a little exaggeration.
And speaking of
it's just that I know my audience very well.
Brookline, there were actually 2,000 people that voted for Trump in Brookline. I discovered today in the Brookline tab.
Sure, Brookline has some white people in it.
I would say most, but I think 23,000 people that did not vote for him.
Here's why. So, there's nothing else to talk about, right? We'll just talk about this.
Well,
let me see what you got.
That is the big thing.
First, number one on the list, Caddyshack, question mark? You're right. You know what? We'll alternate.
Okay, that's fine.
We'll start with Caddyshack, then Trump, then the next thing on
and
your
I have
list,
a series
then Trump.
I have a series of questions. So Caddyshack.
Well, I don't want to take you off of your set list.
Well, I learned. I mean, my we've never met before today. Although
no,
my
but
wife,
we just had a great time in your office.
And my wife did see you after a dentist appointment once, walking through Coolidge Corner.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
My dentist appointment?
No, her. I
have no.
Her dentist appointment, which I think is why she was somewhat. Also,
whenever I come home to see my dad here in Brookline. I go and have a root canal.
See, I believe Sarah, he was wearing shorts. I think that also threw her off.
Wait, where's your wife?
She's right there.
Oh, how do you do? Who's your dentist?
We've since changed. Yeah, so let's mute that on the recording.
Why did you have problems with your dentist?
He was in Brookline and was quite pricey.
Oh, I thought you were going to say he put you under and did something.
No. No, so now I believe we go to, the term is student dentists. Is that right?
Sure.
Yeah. Now we go to dentists in training.
Yeah, like barber school of
yes,
dentistry.
Yes, exactly. Yes.
So I went to a student psychotherapist.
And how did that work out, John?
It was fantastic.
Okay.
I was 20. What are you doing? Taking my picture? I don't show up on film. Are you authorized? That's fine.
She's also Sarah. Most of the people here, I believe, are named Sarah. That is also a Sarah.
I went to, when I was 23 or so, when I moved to New York.
Okay.
Having been graduated from college. And I didn't know what I was going to do with my life. I've talked about this before, so if you've heard it before, shut up. And I was sad and living with a friend in a basement and eating salt and pepper sandwiches and wondering if I had stopped that part of my life where I was becoming something and started the part of my life where I was ending up as something. And I decided I should get some therapy. And luckily, NYU, New York University, offered sliding scale therapy, pay as you can afford therapy, because all of the therapists were students. And the thing that I could not tolerate was the ambiguity of what was going to happen in my life. Because growing up in Brookline, and then going to BHS, and then going to Yale, I had a very clear sense of like, here's the next step, here's the next step, here's the next step.
BHS is Business Harvard School?
Business High School. Business High School of Brookline. I had no business going there. And now all of a sudden I was set loose in the world and all there was for me was ambiguity and it was terrifying because I had no idea what was going to happen. So I would go to this therapist and it helped that she was a beautiful woman.
Okay.
And I mean, look at me. I'm at that time, 23-year-old, only child, Hoovian weirdo. Did not have a mustache, but had all kinds of other affectations. The opportunity to sit in a room and talk to a woman, and she had to listen to me, had never occurred to me before. Had never happened in my life. And you know, therapy is fantastic if you haven't had it. And I honestly feel that it was just the opportunity to have permission to talk about yourself.
Wait, I'm sorry.
Someone else.
Just, you grew up in Brookline, and the first time you had therapy was when you were 23?
Yeah. Well, my
I feel like statistically,
my parents were Catholics. They didn't send me to therapy. They'd stopped being Catholic, so I didn't even have confession.
Right.
I heard about it, and it sounded nice.
Confession.
Yeah. Oh, it sounded
there
interesting.
There are other ways that you can pay women to spend time with them.
Yeah, but I'm shy. I'm not a creep.
I wasn't talking about that.
Oh, then I guess I am a creep.
Go on.
Anyway, it was this incredibly liberating moment to just be able to talk about myself in silence. And truly, she didn't even need to be there. I mean, if you've not had talk therapy, it's to have permission to talk is an amazing thing that not everyone gets to experience. And she might as well have been a cardboard cutout of Captain Kirk, and it would have been the greatest thing in my mental health. But the fact that she was a beautiful woman, I enjoyed talking to her, and I enjoyed her having to listen to me. It was a very unhealthy situation, ultimately. And then, but from my point of view, it was all going well. And then I got, just maybe 4 or 5 weeks into treatment, I got this letter in the mail that was an insurance statement that I had to send to my health insurance to get reimbursed for this. And it had my name and address and date of birth and all this information. And then there was a line that said, diagnosis. I can't remember the number, but it was like 649.2. I'm like, what the fuck is 649.2? Like, they figured it out already. Why am I still going? And I went into the office. The next meeting, and she said, well, would you like to sit down and talk? I'm like, what is diagnosis 649.2? And she said, what are you talking about? I said, you wrote down 649.2. You've diagnosed me. What is it? I have a right to know. She said, it's not, that's just, we have to put something down for insurance purposes that has nothing to do with your ongoing therapy. I'm like, I think it does. I really think it does. She said, no, it's not going to therapeutically help you to know what I put down. And I'm like, well.
That's a bad sign.
I'll be the judge of that. And she said, well, it's a code in the diagnostic statistical manual. And I'm like, get it down. You're telling me there's a rule book for my therapy?
I believe
a dungeon
volume
manual?
Two at
dungeon
the time,
master's manual for
right?
my
the
therapy?
DSM-2.
What's that?
I think it was the DSM-2 in the 90s or 3 maybe.
I don't remember
Go
exactly
on.
Which one it was. And so she pulls it down and she looks it up and she says, okay, here it is. Change of life. Inability to tolerate ambiguity. And I'm like, shit, you're a good therapist. I never had to see her again.
Our therapy bills are very different because mine usually have 8 or 10 numbers, different sets of numbers.
Different sets
them.
Of
yes.
numbers.
Yeah. Sort of like a grab bag, like
sure.
choose your own
you know what, we'll
diagnosis.
Just, yeah, we'll just put down everything.
Right, yes, exactly.
You cross out what you don't think.
Hopefully the insurance will pay for something.
Right.
So. Getting back to what's important.
So Caddyshack.
Yes. I recently was very saddened to discover that you have not seen Caddyshack.
Oh, no, I've seen Caddyshack. Where'd you...
Then you lied on your podcast.
Well, maybe I've seen it since then.
You said,
I
almost quote, golf movies are bad. I will not watch golf movies. That is why I have never seen Caddyshack.
Oh, I think I meant The Legend of Bagger Vance. You know how you get those two confused
it's there,
all the time?
There, yes.
I think that I was leading up to a distortion of the Mark Twain quote.
You were, yes, and when in which you
which
said...
Is that, golf is a good walk spoiled. And I said, Caddyshack is a good comedy movie spoiled by golf.
I think Caddyshack is a good Bill Murray movie spoiled by golf, was the Mark Twain quote, I believe.
But I've seen, I don't know, I think it's one of those that you've seen almost all of it, but in parts over the years.
I'm just now.
At birthday parties and on cable and
your whole,
what have you.
This whole meeting out justice thing now that I find there, that may not all be on the up and up. I'm all of a sudden looking at that
sure.
anew. People have decided right. whether to have barren or witch-like lawns.
So like I told a slight exaggeration on a podcast one time and now I'm disqualified from being president of the United States. I mean,
you really
want to
go
me a
back.
Break.
You
Nothing.
Really want to get
everything's,
back there.
Everything's acceptable now.
Okay, touche.
But is that your favorite movie?
No. It is not.
Well, it's an interesting hill to die on.
But I do feel like, Stripes. So Stripes is one of my favorite movies.
Right.
It is the first time I saw a partially unclothed moving naked woman.
Blair Brown, I believe.
You obviously have delved in way more into that than I have. But I saw it very uncomfortably with a friend's
What's
mother.
That? PJ Souls? From Rock and Roll High School, is the which one?
And the mud wrestling scene?
Oh, the mud, I'm sorry.
Oh, I don't remember the mud wrestling scene. I closed
Wait, what
my
is that
eyes
scene?
That
now
one.
I need to watch it again.
Oh, yes, right. Right.
Oh, yeah. And then she sits on the stove and he pretends to flip her like a pancake.
She was also in Rock and Roll High School.
Boy, wasn't that fun when sexism was allowed?
Yeah. the 80s.
So that's P.J. Souls, not Blair Brown? No, but I think you're right.
Mud wrestling with
P.J.
Souls is the
people. Can we get another lav mic for our IMDb expert?
John. With John Candy, right? Is that right? Mud John wrestling with John Candy?
John Candy was in the mud wrestling scene.
Yeah.
You have to understand, some of these people are younger than we are.
Yes.
They may not.
I thought you were going to say, you have to understand, some of these people are dead.
That may also be
right,
true.
Right, yes. We should have thought about learning the Stripes theme song when we were...
What is the Stripes theme song? I don't
remember. Da 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 da, right? Da 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 da. No? Am I... That went south quickly. Isn't that the...
No, I'm thinking of the 1941 theme song.
Yes, with John Belushi. Okay.
The only good thing about that movie. Have you seen that movie? That's insane.
Wait, no one here has seen 1941?
No, of course not.
Okay.
No, put your hands down. So, what is your favorite Bill Murray movie? Quick!
Me personally or one?
You!
Well, Stripes for sentimental and perverted reasons and Ghostbusters otherwise.
Fair.
Whoa.
Someone said what?
I mean, Groundhog Day fights with Ghostbusters sometimes.
Groundhog Day is a perfect movie. And you know what's not a perfect movie?
Ghostbusters?
Ghostbusters. Yeah. But Ghostbusters is a very lovable movie. You know what is a perfect movie with Bill Murray in it?
Groundhog Day?
Wait. One at a time. Everyone.
Scrooge is not the answer.
I already said Groundhog Day. Scrooge is not the answer.
Yeah.
Not the answer I'm looking for. Raise your hand, please. Here.
Rushmore?
Close. Not the answer I'm looking for.
Razor's Edge.
Ah!
I've never actually seen it.
You have
Razor's
to remember,
Edge.
There's an audience here. It's not just
yes,
me in
right,
your office
right.
anymore. Not two 44, 45-year-old guys.
Right.
My dad took me to see Razor's Edge. W. Somerset, Mom, I was pretentious. Yes?
At Cleveland Circle?
Moonrise Kingdom was the answer I was looking for.
Ah.
A perfect movie. Well done.
You're breaking into Rocky Top early.
You win a tub of hummus. Hand that back to her, please. Although Rushmore is also a perfect movie, that was close with a bullet.
Rushmore was. I'm beginning to rethink starting this sentence, but I have not seen Moonrise Kingdom.
Oh no, that's fine.
Oh.
I mean, I agree with you. Insofar as it's a wonderful movie.
She's now going to quit.
But it's not like if you had said, I have not seen Caddyshack or whatever.
Right, exactly. Right.
Really upset. It's not part of the canon to my dismay.
Outside of Razor's Edge, are there any bad Bill Murray movies?
Space Jam.
I'm not sure I would even call that a Bill Murray movie.
I'd like to pretend that it's a starring Bill Murray movie that is bad.
Hmm?
Hands up
what?
If you've got one. I'm kind of blanking, but I know that they exist.
What?
Garfield. And then there was that one with an elephant? Where the Buffalo Roam.
Oh,
that's Hunter S. Thompson.
Yeah. Let's back off, Hunter.
He's a big Hunter S. Thompson fan.
Yeah.
Did you like that?
Nothing.
Yeah.
Sir?
Yes.
I thought that Hunter is a difficult person to capture on film, and he actually portrayed him quite accurately. I think what it possibly showed is that it is not fun spending 2 hours watching Hunter Thompson.
Did you know Hunter Thompson in life?
I did know Hunter, and I can confirm that it was not fun
I can
watching
tell you
him.
That you knew him because you keep calling him Hunter. Were you best friends?
No.
Were you? Enemies?
No, he would occasionally call me at 3 a.m. and inevitably I would pick up the phone and he would say, Seth, are you doing anything weird? And I would have to explain that I was asleep, as I always was at 3 a.m, and the only one of us who might be doing something weird was him.
How did you come to know him?
I came to know him because I was dating his editor. And I found...
Not anymore, I hope.
I discovered, no. And I discovered that editor had a dual role as babysitter at that point in his life, and so ended up out there.
His editor would babysit him.
Yeah, sort of writing. I sometimes feel like I could use this, but getting him to write would mean literally sitting with him in a room while he bet on sports and then getting him to try and give a sentence at a time for days on end. You can see
that
why.
That sounds like a great way to be a writer, except for the betting on sports part.
Such good friends. Yeah, he would, yeah. He
so would, she would sit there and he would talk and she would write it down?
Yes.
It's hardly even writing.
Yes.
Do you still know her by any chance?
I do still know her, yes. I do still know her, yeah.
So you were dating his editor.
Yeah.
And were you a big Hunter Thompson fan?
I was previous to that,
right.
Yes. Yeah. I was,
well, then,
and I also ended up writing a piece about him in which I said that it was too bad he had squandered all of his talent.
You were counting
that.
On the fact that he couldn't read?
No, but I think he, at that point in his life in the early aughts, late 90s, early aughts.
When did he die?
2004?
Boy, some best friend you are.
Ish.
Okay.
He was mainly surrounded by sycophants and toadies. So I think that the fact that I wrote a piece saying, wow, it really sucks what he's done for the last 15 or 20 years, which was, I think, undeniably true, he, for some reason, appreciated.
He appreciated it?
Yeah.
Oh, so he reached out to you after you had...
He started calling me at 3 in the morning and asking me if I was doing anything weird. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
What do you think he was hoping to hear?
I do not know. I do not know. I think he was trying to
Did you ever do anything weird with him?
I did not. I mean, I got in a car with him driving.
That sounds bad.
In the Red Shark, the car made famous, and then we drove down an unlit mountain road in Woody Creek, Colorado, to a burger joint, and I thought, I've had a decent life. If it all ends right now. We made it there and back.
Yeah.
But no, I did not do anything
But
weird.
You survived.
I did.
In this timeline.
Yeah, exactly. On Earth 1.
Yeah.
On Earth 2, where we now have the first...
In that timeline, you died, but Hillary Clinton...
But Hillary Clinton was elected president, which is a sacrifice
Thanks
I will
a lot,
make.
Seth.
I will make. Well,
I'm sure your wife and children are
I know,
happy.
I was going to say, I might need to finagle that a little bit.
All right, Earth 3, we did Caddyshack.
On Earth 3... I survived and Hillary Clinton was president. So let's go there.
I'd like to go there. Can you open a portal right away?
Well, we are. We're going to explore that later through music.
That's true. Oh, yeah. I thought we were going to just have a hoedown the entire time.
Do you want to do Rocky Top?
No, that's the closer, dude.
I am not. We're not starting with Should I Stay or Should I Go?
No. I know 3 other songs.
Okay. All right. I thought that exhausted the songs we were together, but.
Oh no, those are the 2 songs we're gonna do together.
Okay, so you're just gonna.
If you have a couple of solo songs, you can do those.
You should play and I should tune.
So,
do you know a mandolin player? Usually I tell this joke about banjo players. A mandolin player and a ukulele player jump off a cliff. Who lands first?
A mandolin player and a banjo player jump off a cliff.
Ukulele.
Oh, mandolin player and a ukulele player.
A mandolin player is necessary for the joke.
Got it. All right, that gives me a clue. Let me go to the blackboard, I'll figure this out. We must have some engineers in the audience. What's the relative air displacement of a banjo versus a mandolin versus a ukulele? Gosh, Seth, I don't know. Who lands first?
The
mandolin
ukulele player, because right. The mandolin player is still tuning his instrument.
Ah.
Mandolin humor, folks. Thank you very much.
Yeah, so I'm going to Seattle tomorrow to perform a show in which I sing a song. And so I had it with me, and I walked into the office, and Seth said, I play the mandolin. I'm like, let's just have a hoedown. Let's just sing songs, because everything is terrible. And I don't know a lot of songs.
And then I said, I don't really play the mandolin, unfortunately.
Right. And then he's like, "Can you want to play Uncle John's band?" And I said, "I am getting on the next train home. Thank you very much."
I think that the Grateful Dead is slotted for later in the discussion.
All right.
Right? You're not a fan.
I'm not. Everyone likes what they like. It's not for me.
I'm used to being alone on that hill.
It's a
with lots of patchouli drenched tippies.
It's a smelly hill to be on.
It's a smelly white hill to be on. Yes, I did. I brought my 6-year-old son to a Dead show this summer.
Well, but it couldn't have been a Dead show.
It was a Dead and Company show. Yes.
What does that mean?
It means that it is starring John Mayer in the role of Jerry Garcia, which is not as bad as it sounds.
I didn't know it could get worse.
Truly, truly not as bad as it sounds. But he
John
stayed.
Mayer.
He stayed for the whole thing. We can.
What are you doing? You're playing the song.
The instrumental interlude in Uncle John's Band.
Yeah, do Uncle John's Band, and then we'll come right back after the break.
But yes.
John Mayer, all right, so.
My wife can also attest, John Mayer was much better. First of all, he wore polka dots? Checks. Madras checks. A Madras jumpsuit, shorts jumpsuit, which I felt like he should get credit for that.
What kind of credit?
Credit, like it is the most ridiculous thing any human being could wear. And also, very ostentatiously, on the two nights, I went to both nights.
He dressed like an overdressed baby.
Wore like distinct, but very gaudy and visible, like $80,000 watches.
With his baby suit.
No, he only wore the baby suit one night.
Is his Grateful Dead personality, "I'm a rich baby."
No comment.
Are you gonna play the song?
No.
Oh, okay.
I'm not. Yeah. Why don't you do your song?
All right. So, it's a bummer. Everything's a bummer. And yet I'm glad to be here, and I only know a few ukulele songs, and sometimes you don't feel like talking about what's going on. It hurts. The reason that it hurts is not merely that it's a disappointment, but not merely because, like a death of a loved one, it breaks time in half, such that forever after there will be the before and the after of this election, and the after of this election is terrifying and unbearable seeming, and we don't know how we will possibly go on, and we don't know what this person is going to do, because he never meaningfully spoke about policy, and I think we all intuited that his head is a writhing bag of snakes, and we don't. he simply says what comes into his mind at that time, whatever it'll take to get the faceless mannequins around him to cheer him. And
comedian John Hodgman, everyone.
it's a terrifying moment, and it hurts not because of him, to me anyway, but because we know on some level that it was meant to hurt, that there are a lot of people who voted for Donald Trump because they were very, very angry at some amorphous collection of enemies that Donald Trump conjured up for them. And we are among those enemies. You know, whether we are non-straight white dudes or people who hang around prestigious universities in the Northeast, or immigrants, or anything, or women. This was designed to hurt us. They didn't care about what happened today or yesterday. They cared about what happened when he won, and we felt bad. And that, you know, we were asked to feel a lot of empathy by the news media for Trump voters, and I do feel a lot of empathy. There are a lot of people who've been left behind by this economy and by malfeasance on both sides of the aisle, but we know because they bragged about it, that a lot of the Trump voters were not voting for Trump because they were hurting, they were voting for Trump because they wanted to hurt people. and I felt hurt, and my daughter felt hurt, and probably people you know felt hurt, and we're looking forward to a future where maybe people don't just feel hurt, but are hurt and displaced. That's a real drag. And the only way I know how to get through it is because I grew up in Massachusetts, the birthplace of rage and spite. I have experienced this before. A total disregard for policy or the long-term view. Can I make that person mad? Can I hurt that person? And you may know that the mayor of Boston, Marty Walsh, wanted, even before he was mayor, to make a particular song the official rock song of the Commonwealth of Massachusetts.
Roadrunner.
Roadrunner by Jonathan Richman and the Modern Lovers.
Fantastic
and that's a perfect
song. Great song.
Perfect. It's a great song. And, you know, let's just put it this way. It was the most qualified song
it was
to become
if that
the official rock song
of
the Commonwealth
platform,
of Massachusetts.
If that had been the only thing he ran on,
yeah.
I would have voted for him.
And, you know, it's a great song. It's a beautiful song. It's got Massachusetts in it.
Stop and Shop.
It's got Stop and Shop in it, Route 128 in
going
it.
1,000 miles an hour.
And what happened was it was going to speed through the legislature and become the official rock song of the Commonwealth.
It's radio
and then
on.
Someone else in Massachusetts heard that another person in Massachusetts wanted something. And that was not allowed to stand. And so those other legislators in Massachusetts, when they heard that Marty Walsh wanted this, for no reason other than to spite him, introduced another song in competition to be official rock song of the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, and they got into a legislative death battle, and both songs died in committee.
What was the other song?
That song was Dream On by Aerosmith.
Oh, yeah. Ah.
And that is definitely a song. And it's a pretty good song, but it is not a rock song. That is a power ballad. This is a rock song.
We can have some nice things, though, because in Massachusetts, because the Red Sox do still have Dirty Water as their victory song, which I think is a clear win for the forces of good in the universe. Any song that celebrates, I think, muggers, lovers, and thieves in the chorus is a song I'll take any day. And that celebrates a polluted river as opposed to New York, New York.
One question, though. What are the Red Sox? Roadrunner, roadrunner, going faster miles an hour. Gonna drive to the Stop and Shop with my radio on. I'm in love with Massachusetts and the neon when it's cold outside. In the highway when it's late at night. I got my radio on. I'm the roadrunner. I'm in love with modern moonlight. Route 128 when it's dark outside. I'm in love with Massachusetts. I'm in love with the radio on. Helps me not be so lonely late at night. Helps you not feel so alone late at night. Don't feel so bad now, I'm in the car. Don't feel so alone, I got my radio on. I'm the roadrunner. That's right. Welcome to the spirit of 1956. Patient in the bushes next to 57. The highway's your girlfriend as you go by quick. Suburban trees, suburban speed, and it smells like heaven. I said, Roadrunner once, Roadrunner twice. I'm in love with rock and roll, y'all. And I'll be out all night. Not all night, I got a plane to catch to Seattle tomorrow. Roadrunner, Roadrunner, going faster miles an hour. Gonna drive right to the Stop and Shop. Gonna drive with my radio on. And me in love with modern moonlight. Me in love with modern rock and roll. Modern girls and modern rock and roll. I'm gonna drive with my radio on. I'm the roadrunner. Now you sing, modern lovers. Radio on! Radio on! Why aren't you? You all have to be singing. Don't you understand? This is the sing-along portion. Do you not know the song? You might not know the song. Some of you are young. Some of you are old. All you have to do is shout, sing, radio on, radio on, radio on, radio on, radio off? No, always radio on. Even when I'm singing something different, then that's what you sing. Radio on!
Radio on. Radio on.
Good, but louder.
Radio on.
Right?
Radio on.
Yes.
Radio on.
Radio on. I got the AM.
Radio on.
I got the car. I got the AM now.
Radio
I got the,
on.
I got the car from Massachusetts now.
Radio
I got the,
on.
The power of Massachusetts now.
Radio
I have the power of Cambridge, Massachusetts.
Radio
I have the power of Western Massachusetts.
Radio
I have the power of Heath School.
Radio
I have the power of the Pioneer Valley now.
Radio
I have the power of Greenfield, Massachusetts.
Radio
Greenfield is not a shithole.
Radio
just an ordinary town with some economic problems.
Radio
I have the power of the Mohawk Trail.
Radio
also known as Route 2.
Radio
Route 2. That's the first song of our hoedown.
What chords are those? What are the two chords?
What chords are they?
What are the two chords?
I'm never going to tell you.
All right.
D and A. I should have told you that and you could have done it with me.
A?
This is like Massachusetts dueling banjos.
All right.
So we talked about Trump. We talked about Caddyshack.
Yes.
Let's talk about your action figures.
Okay.
I like them all.
Where do you want to start? Well, how about, why don't we start in Mos Eisley? Over here.
More wretched hive of scum and villainy. Words, words, words. What's the rest of the quote? You will never find. Ugh, even Obi-Wan was talking Yoda talk then.
Never find
object
you.
Before subject.
So, first of all, does anyone have this Lego set? Oh my fucking God.
So you guys may
no one here owns Mos Eisley?
I don't.
Wow.
Is it a collector's item, Seth?
Well, funny you should ask. When I started buying Lego several years ago, I did it by accident because I purchased a set that I thought I was going to build with my two-year-old, and it was for ages 16 and up.
Sure.
Which I did not realize.
By the way, there are no Lego sets for two-year-olds. Unless they're those eating Lego sets.
Well, there are Duplos. Duplos.
Yeah, no, we're not going to talk about
no,
Duplos.
No, I would prefer we don't. So
bunch of garbage. You know, you use a Duplo for it. You use that to make a jetty. You throw it into the sea.
You can also, if you need to make very oversized, let's move on from Duplos.
I'm glad you found some use for Duplo.
But so I, this was a yay big model.
I'll mail you all the Duplo I have left.
That see, you
in
should
a burning box.
You should be careful because we have already asked everyone we know to donate their Lego to us. And now
yeah,
I would say
Lego is good. Duplo no good. You
okay.
Want that Duplo?
No, we don't.
I'll send it to you. I got some sweet Duplo. I'm not gonna brag. But it never captured our children's attention.
Do you know that, and my wife did not believe me when I said this, that Duplo also attached to Lego?
Ooh. I'm with you. I think your husband's gone mad. How do they attach? You can put a Lego on a Duplo?
Yeah.
Huh. They Lego do attach. On a Duplo. Yeah.
So I built this R2-D2 and discovered that...
Lego R2-D2. By yourself.
About yay big.
While your son was screaming, pay attention to me, daddy. Must finish.
I did this. I don't think any of my former thesis students were here, but I did this solely while I was having meetings with my thesis students. And I told them it was a way to gauge their progress.
How so?
They did not ask how so, because there's no scenario in which that actually makes sense. But what I discovered was that for people with acute anxiety, Lego can be quite meditative.
Sure.
Because you take things and you stick them in places they're supposed to go, and they click together very satisfyingly.
Yeah.
So I started spending a frightening amount of money on Lego.
And you slowly build a model of a whole healthy person.
Yes, exactly. Over time. I'm still filling that hole inside.
I am with you 100%.
But then the amount I started to spend became a little bit frightening, so I told myself and my wife, and actually got my father to invest in this scheme.
That's your father?
Yes.
How do you do, sir?
That it made sense. If I bought two of every Lego set, we could keep one in the attic. Mm-hmm. And then when they stopped making it, we could sell it, and I would get the money back for the one that I built, so it would be like having Lego for free.
It's a hobby that would pay for itself.
Yes.
Because Lego discontinues its sets.
Over time.
And they do have a high resale.
That R2-D2, which initially sold for $120, now sells for $500.
Well, that's you could have had quite a return.
I did not buy two of that.
Oh, I see.
Yes. Yeah.
You got burned in the
R2-D2. The ones that I have so far bought two of have not had that same return. But I do have a very large Sydney Opera House, if anyone is in the market for one, unopened.
What's that going for now on the resale?
Well, they have not stopped making it, so it is going for, I believe, the $320 that Lego sells it for. But if you get in now, once they stop making it, I will sell it to you for $380.
How many duplicate sets of Lego do you have, unopened duplicate sets of Lego do you have in your storage?
Well, let's talk money. Monetary
value. I don't
want
to talk about money.
I have a duplicate Death Star.
I don't want to hear about each one.
I would say probably...
There have been a lot of Death Stars.
No, there have not. There have been three.
You know what? When you're talking Lego, three is a lot to me.
Well, until recently, there were only two. One of them goes for $5,000. I do not have the duplicate of that one.
Which one do you have?
I have the one that they only stopped making last month.
The new dupe.
Your
duplicate is the newest.
Is
one.
The new? Yes, yes, yeah, yeah. The one that is goes for lots of money is the one that is being reconstructed from Empire.
In Return of the Jedi.
Empire?
Nope.
Jedi? Oh, fuck. Good Lord. Oh man, this night is going to shit. Anyway, I thought I was on firm ground here. I am clearly not.
No.
I do not.
Your
what I want to talk about
is not completed.
What I want to.
Your shields are not fully functional.
but when they show it like with pieces falling off of it, that's
yes.
a Jedi.
Yes.
Damn. All right.
Have you seen these movies?
I've seen them. My wife and I rewatched all of them multiple times before the one that fixed it all came out last year.
Yep, I did it again.
This should make things right. The opening line of
yes,
the
yes, I know, very controversial.
Not controversial. The prequels were awful, and that fixed
well,
it.
Well, not controversial among audiences. That was the thing. That line at the beginning of The Force Awakens is what. Pissed off George Lucas.
Yes, that is true. And
rumor
yes.
has it.
That caused a rift. A rift in the force.
It caused a rift. And well, how far down the Star Wars rabbit hole are we going
well,
to go?
Well, so let's. I'm going to pull us back a little bit.
Not to cross fantasy properties.
I would like to talk about the.
So talk to me about your Mos Eisley set.
About this scene right here.
Okay.
Actually, I'm sorry.
For those of you who are not on stage, Seth is making reference to the scene where Han Solo and Greedo are having just a little get together. There are various versions of what happens during this get together. Sometimes Greedo shoots first, sometimes Han shoots first.
Well,
I saw a version where they just really kind of opened up to each other. So what do you want to tell me about
that? I want to talk about the Han shot first. So clearly Han shot first.
Yes. It established his character as an amoral criminal who had to go on an arc of redemption during that first movie.
In the face of tyranny and death, is it appropriate ever to meet tyranny with tyranny or meet the threat of death with preemptive death?
We just went back to Trump all of a sudden.
Yes. Does everyone know this scene? So Greedo is explaining that
these people all knew what Return of the Jedi was. I think they probably know.
Radio on. Yes, and Han shot first. There are versions where that has been edited. But Han shot first. And so you think that establishes him as amoral?
Well, Okay, so there are two ways to talk about this. Was it an intrinsically moral act? That is to say, would I ever shoot Greedo first? Probably that guy was weird. And then there is a contextual argument narrative argument, as to whether it made sense that Han shot first, that Han murdered a Greedo in cold blood.
There are more than, you think it's a race of clones?
No, he's a Rodian.
Okay.
Greedo is a Rodian. Greedo is his name.
Right, but you said a Greedo.
I was making a deep cut joke by misstating what it was. So whether it was moral for Han to shoot Greedo first, was Greedo necessarily going to kill him?
I would say yes.
Well,
I'm not sure that's
true because I've never had this conversation before and I'm really into it. I would say, I don't blame you for walking out, sir. Have a good night. Good luck to you. Do me a favor before you go, shut and lock the doors.
He's going to join the resistance.
If Greedo was trying to collect a bounty that was set on Han's head, and to justify murdering Greedo, Han would have to believe that the bounty was on Han's head, dead or alive, and that Greedo was intending to kill him, and that Greedo might kill him at any moment. Therefore, Han would have to shoot him. But if Greedo was going to kill Han at any moment, he would never have ever said a word to Han Solo. He would have come up behind him and shot him in the back of the head. Because when Han shoots Greedo, everyone turns around for a second, and then they go back to Cantina Song Number 1.
Right.
And no one gives
That's
a,
why I
no one gives a Bantha Pundu about
it.
So we have to conclude that Greedo's intent was to take Han alive under threat of death, and Han didn't want to do that. And therefore murdered Greedo.
So
is there a flaw in my argument? Does anyone
yes.
feel?
Yes.
Sir,
yeah.
Go ahead. I had a feeling.
Hi there, long time, first time. So, this is about to happen.
This is about to happen.
I think
everything is happening according to my plan. Mm-hmm.
That Han is operating under the logical assumption that Greedo may not be the agent of his demise, but when he returns him to people that have put the bounty on him,
Jabba the Hutt,
he will not be killed there.
Well,
there is a flaw in that logic in that he was not killed when he was brought to
Thank
Java.
You, Seth Mnookin. Yes. It may be. What is your name?
What?
What is your name, sir?
Isaac, hello.
Isaac, hello. It may be, and it may be in Han's mind that he believes that when he is taken back to see Jabba the Hutt, that he will be instantly murdered. But we know that that isn't what happened. And moreover, in the original script and in the original cut, after Han murders Greedo, Jabba meets him in the hangar before they take off, before Luke and Obi-Wan Kenobi get there.
And in the recut version.
And in the unmentionable recut version. And does not murder him again. And simply says, please pay me the money sometime. Now, Han has been working for Jabba the Hutt before, so I think that Han commits a heinous act in murdering Greedo. But intrinsically, morally, in the context of the narrative, it is important that he do that because he's not a hero at the beginning of the movie. He's a mercenary. And what you see is Han gradually finding a moral compass by the end of the movie. And that's what makes his return to bail out Luke in the Battle of Yavin 4 so important to his growth as a character. So from a writerly point of view, it's absurd that Greedo would have shot first. Han needs to be a murderer at the beginning and needs to be a savior at the end. The end. Next question. Other questions about Mos Eisley?
Well,
here, we have a note. We're gonna open to a formal Q&A, but I don't mind if you jump in at any time. The question was, how do we know Greedo dies? If you
yeah.
see...
yeah.
You think Han shot to wound?
He falls over. I mean, he's shot point blank from
Maybe
this distance.
He set,
and,
you know what?
And
what is your name?
Sean.
Maybe Han's set for stun. But that would make for a worse story if it were true. Greedo is murdered by Han. Han is a murderer. We all have to deal with reality now. Do you understand? Donald Trump is not a normal candidate. He's a bigot. He harnessed bigotry to get the presidency. We cannot treat his presidency as normal. We cannot offer to unify the country by accepting him, because a line must be drawn, a moral line must be drawn. And bigotry is on the other side of that line as a country. And even though, whatever, I mean, you know, our country was founded on exclusion and genocide and racism, but as a matter of principle that we have been working towards, we've been trying to not do that, and we cannot simply say, oh yeah, Donald Trump, just another president. Normalizing Donald Trump is normalizing evil. And I don't even think he's evil. I think he's just a sociopath that evil people used as their weapon. And so that's what I have to say. Yes?
This better be about Greedo.
Which, who are you talking about, me?
She's definitely talking
yes.
about me.
Oh, okay, I'm not telling you to attack.
No, but when that line is drawn in the sand and the person on the other side is going to try and bring you down, to bring you down and dismiss what you just said by bringing us down.
Are you the other person? Who's the other person?
The bigots who are choosing the other side of the line.
Oh. I'm not worried about bigots choosing the other side of the line. That's their choice. I mean, you know, I think that they're going to have to reckon with their consciences and history and time. I'm more worried about
people on our, ostensibly on our side of the line, who take Donald Trump's conciliatory message in his victory speech at face value. And we can't. And I don't say this to say that Donald Trump is an evil liar. He's simply something who will say whatever comes into his mind at that moment in order to make the people around him applaud. And, you know, to me, I feel it's like those of us who choose to not be bigots and to stand on the side of the most vulnerable people, or any vulnerable people in our society, have to stay on this side of the line. And I include Democratic politicians and media in that. Do you know what I mean? That I would just encourage people to not normalize what's happened. There's a huge, I mean, you know, I don't feel, I was of mixed mind about President Obama, who's my hero, meeting with Trump today, because I want to say, you're letting down the people, your daughters, you know? Because I know how my daughter felt when an intensely qualified woman lost to a fatuous, dilettante, creepy man because he felt like running that year. It's monstrous. The only thing that made it better was someone on Twitter today floated the idea, and I've really taken it to heart, that Obama is reaching out to Trump because if he doesn't, if we don't keep the line of communication open with Trump, he'll only be surrounded by Breitbart, not Breitbart, but you know, what's his name from Breitbart?
Steve Bannon.
And Pence and Gingrich and Giuliani. And the reality of Trump is he's incredibly susceptible to other points of view if you flatter him. And I'm like, oh, I didn't think about that. Maybe Barack Obama's idea is to become Donald Trump's best friend. and to control him. And I'm like, Barack Obama could do that. He totally could do that. Maybe that's the ninth dimensional chess Barack Obama is playing. And you know what? I bet you on some level he's like, yeah, I want to keep a channel of communication open to this guy so he can hear from the person who was president before what this is really all about. I pity Donald Trump. I feel like he is, I mean, what we haven't talked about, and it sounds like a slur, and I don't mean it that way, that he is mentally ill. And we can't talk about it because it's a huge accusation to make, especially since we don't want to be in a world where being mentally ill is an accusation. Do you know what I mean? Like, but he's got a different perception of reality than we have. And I feel like it's almost our job to remind him as much as anyone else that bigotry of any kind is not acceptable in the American conversation. And he, I hope, I don't know if it's possible, but you know, if he were to atone in some meaningful way for unleashing what he has unleashed, then I would normalize his presidency. But until then, I'm just like, no, you're still not okay in my book. But I'm certainly not telling anyone what to do, and I'm certainly not a celebrity. You know, I mean, look, I couldn't even fill up this hall. Come on. I mean, I love you all, but where are your friends, you guys?
So, I mean, this is something I've been thinking a lot about.
But here's what I think you should do. No, now I'm going to tell you what to do. I'm sorry, Seth.
Yeah, no.
If you don't agree with me, fine. If you do agree with me, then, you know, Elizabeth Warren, my dad just sent me an email that she sent out where she really, you know, after saying, I'm going to work with the new president to, you know, reform banking, which is her crusade, and she's an incredibly impressive and wonderful person. But I was still like, don't work with him. Like, she sent out an email that was very reassuring that she was going to hold his feet to the fire on these issues. And I would just say, write to your congresspeople and say to them, please don't please oppose the president. Please treat this president with all due skepticism and suspicion. And remember who you're representing. I think that actually is a meaningful thing to do. And then obviously prepare for the midterms, because we have to take back the Senate and the House if we can. Now, what did you want to say, Seth? Also, whiskey helps.
I picked the wrong year to stop drinking. It's actually 19 years ago.
If you had called me then, I would have said wrong year, Seth.
I think
you don't know what's going to happen in 19 years.
Pretty confident it was the right decision, actually. But
I'm glad for you.
I've been thinking about this a lot, it's incredibly difficult, obviously, to feel powerless, especially in the face of something that threatens the values that you hold dear, and or the values that I hold dear, and what I thought I knew and understood about this country. I've been struggling with how to find a way forward that does not involve just sobbing every day, which I think is, first of all, not a great thing to do if you're a parent, because that conveys anxiety to your children, which I'm also trying not to do. But there are a couple of things I've done in the last couple of days, including reaching out to Republicans that I know, Republicans who were very opposed to Trump. But the reason I've been reaching out to them is on the theory that, he has the power, and he has both houses of Congress now. And he is someone who has shown that when he feels threatened or pushed into a corner, he will lash out and strike back in ways that now that he is president can be really, really dangerous. And so I would rather have people, I don't expect Obama and Trump to be BFFs, but I would rather have people that, while I may disagree with them on some things, I agree with on basic values involving respect and a belief in humanity and a belief in science and climate change, because the prospects for what could happen in 4 years or in 2 years are too frightening to consider.
What are the conversations that you're having with these, when you say Republicans, are you talking about friends who are Republican voters or
no,
Republican
lawmakers? No, I'm
talking
about like campaign managers for presidential candidates, primarily in campaign strategists. And I've been talking to them. I mean, I reached out to them and said, we're on different sides of the political aisle and we disagree about a lot of things, but I think there are more basic things that we agree about, and I would be interested in talking to you about ways that we can work together to mitigate the effects of a Trump presidency.
You know, I've had a huge shift just over the past 12 hours about, like, you shouldn't talk to those people. I'm not your friends, I'm
sure.
I mean, it's like,
no, they're not.
Every citizen is my neighbor as far as I'm concerned. And I greet them with love even if they're not my friends. Do you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And what the Republican, there, for those of you who don't like a two-party system, doesn't exist anymore. Because the Republican Party doesn't exist anymore. There is a Trumpist movement that Trump activated that like a parasite, like that fungus that takes over the brain of an ant, has invaded the Republican Party, and the remaining Republicans You know, I mean, but that's what it, that's what it is.
They're fungus fans.
Yeah, sure.
Fans.
Oh, sure. But I mean, you know, like, the remaining Republicans are left wondering what happened to their party and the principles of that party, because Trump flouts all social conservatism, and he flouts, you know, if he seems hardcore on certain traditionally Republican issues now, he was exactly the opposite 15 years ago.
Not even 15 years ago.
You know, or not even that, right? Yeah. So he's this completely unpredictable parasite who has activated a core of angry people, largely in rural America, which is a place that I love, you know, and they don't know how to deal with it. They don't know what to do. They are torn whether to disavow it in order to maintain some sort of mainstream respectability, or to throw mainstream respectability away because these people will ride them to power. And you watch them go back and forth, back and forth, back and forth between whether to embrace or disavow Trump. And right now they feel like, well, those who stuck with him, Christie, Giuliani, Gingrich, and even McConnell, and to a in a weird degree, Ryan, like they feel like they've won. But they still don't know what's going, none of us know what's going to happen. He has no policy, you know, it's like, he's complete, by definition, he's completely unpredictable. The Republican Party is going to dance at his whim. And if they think that they're going to be able to get in there and control the policy the way Dick Cheney controlled the Bush presidency, I don't know that that's, maybe, but I don't know that that's going to happen either.
Yeah.
And, but my change of thinking has been, like, initially I was like, what's been revealed is that the Republican Party, and I've never said this, but I've never felt this, even in the darkest years of the Bush presidency, where I felt the triumphal wing of the Republican Party loved to dance on the grave of liberal Democrats and say that we weren't American. Do you know, like, even then, I'd never felt that they weren't my neighbors and friends, and the Republican Party should be done with. But now I feel like, how can you support a party that clearly sold out every one of its principles for power? It's absurd, you know? And so, but it was that one tweet, it was on the train here, where that person said, we need to keep a line of communication open to Donald Trump from a pragmatic point of view, because that's the only, he is influenceable.
Yeah.
And I was like, yeah, you know, we need to keep those lines of communication open. And I think it's, you know, between high-powered university elites and Republican strategists, that line needs to stay open. From soon-to-be former presidents and soon-to-be future presidents, that line needs to stay open. And then individual to individual, family to family, like if you know if you're related to a Trump voter, keep the line open. As much as it feels so maybe satisfying to suggest that you close that window shade, the more that you talk to people, the more that your point of view becomes normal to them. And I can't remember the person on Twitter who had written a very powerful series of tweets about having grown up in the Midwest. And his thesis was, like, we talk about having to reach out to voters in rural communities who supported Trump and as a mode of empathy. And sure, we do. We need to know what these people are thinking and feeling. We can't ignore their experience. But at the same time, they need to reach out to us. People who live in towns in the country don't have the same experience with the outside, with the world that we do. Cities exist because trade happened here. Trade happened in Boston, trade happened in New York, in Philadelphia, in Chicago, in Los Angeles. They exist on oceans, they exist on rivers, They exist because people were coming and buying and selling stuff, and that introduced people within the cities to other points of view. There's a reason we call city people cosmopolitan. We are a people of the world. There was no way for us to imagine a world in which there weren't people of other faiths, beliefs, orientations. Like, it just was obvious. And that one-on-one contact with other people of the world taught us over centuries, and this goes back forever. Cities have always been more liberal and open and tolerant because we see other people all the time. And we know they're human, you know? We know they're human. Whereas people who live in the interior, who farm or mine or live in small closed communities, I mean, these are wonderful communities, but they're defined by the fact that they rely on each other to survive, and not a lot of people come in or leave. And so it is baked into the DNA of those communities to rely on each other to survive and to be suspicious of outsiders. Well, I don't need to look at polling data, but the polling data, I think, backs me up that those are the people who voted for Donald Trump. They're suspicious of everything that's happening as the world becomes more and more a city and less a small country town.
But it's a lot. I mean, if those were the only people who voted for Donald Trump, then there wouldn't be a Trump presidency. I mean, that's not the
I disagree with you.
Just numerically, there are not enough.
Numerically, most people in the United States voted for Hillary Clinton. I mean,
less than
half of the people who are registered to vote voted, and less than half of those people voted for Donald Trump. And most of those people voted in the rural white communities that voted for Republican presidents in the past two elections. I mean, I'm not saying this to diminish those people. I'm only saying it to say this is a completely classic divide in civilization that goes back to Rome. People who live in cities are more tolerant. People who live in the country are more skeptical. I've lived in both places, and I appreciate the values and the virtues of both. But because of air travel and internet and everything else, we are becoming a global community. It's not a coincidence that the guiding conspiracy theory among the alt-right is that certain, probably Jewish elites want to make a one-world government. That is the anxiety that fuels so much, if not all, of the revolution that we just saw 2 days ago. I mean, I'm sorry to take such a hard stance on it, but it's like, people say, what's wrong with us as a country that Donald Trump is elected? It's not what's wrong with us as a country. Less than a quarter of us voted for him. But they are our neighbors as well. And it's on us and it's on them to find common ground in the future. And what I really, in a weird way, and perhaps this is the bargaining stage of grief, like, I kind of feel like the key is, who has the ear of Donald Trump? I mean, who
has the ear?
Who has the ear of Donald Trump?
Right.
Because I absolutely think Donald Trump is the kind of guy who will be really excited that Barack Obama wants to be friends with him. Yeah. He's like, he's the guy who's like, hey, guess what? I'm friends with the former president of the United States. Doesn't matter to him that he's the president of the United States. You know, like, he's like, hey, guess what? I actually have a black friend now. I have no idea if that's the game that's being played right now, and maybe that's the only thing that gives me a little bit of cheer in the moment, but I kind of feel like, from a purely practical point of view, we know what we're dealing with Donald Trump in that he is utterly unpredictable and completely susceptible to flattery. And yeah, you know what? If that's the game that Barack Obama is playing, go for it. Like, maybe that'll keep us from, maybe reaching out in all kinds of different ways will keep us from the outcome that we're most afraid of.
Right.
Anyone want to jump in? I mean, yeah.
So, Denmark?
You're from Denmark?
Yes, I am.
Well, good for you.
can we move in with you? Can we move in with you?
Yeah. Look at, hey, hang on, what is your name?
Adam.
Adam?
Yeah.
And you're from Denmark and you have those awesome clear frame glasses. You're like Bernie Sanders' dream. I wish it could come true.
Well, even though, you know, Trumpism is happening all over the world, and I would say that in Denmark, Trumpism happened 20 years ago. So what the
What do you mean by that?
I mean that there was exactly the same movement that you were explaining, the exact same story. So it's about the city and the countryside. And there was anxiety. We had immigration that caused anxiety, and that led to the rise of a far-right wing party. But they were populists, and they had the same rhetoric as Trump. And all of a sudden, they were in parliament. And the liberal lost power. And they all of a sudden, they made it their policy to stop the conversation. And the minute they did that, rage doubled, and the influence of the far right doubled. So now they're the second largest party in the parliament. That's what happened. So please, just keep the conversation going.
Yeah.
And you know, keep those meetings happening between Barack Obama and Donald Trump. I think that's your only hope.
Well, Barack Obama, you know, came to office with the power that he was going to reach across, with the promise, I should say, that he to reach across the aisle, and that there was not two Americas, that there was one United States of America. And it really bothered a lot of people on the left that he meant it. And of course, he was rejected for 8 years. But at the same time, I think there's something magical about the fact that even the person who spent years denying his legitimacy as president, that Barack Obama would meet him in friendship and, I dare say, love. And I think that that's something I only came to appreciate on the train here. So I'm just saying, it took me hours to get to where I am today. Yeah. You can't hear the gentleman said he shares my gall. We share a gallbladder. I always wanted to meet you. Yeah.
You know, and I mean, this is a, and your fear, this is a person that has said in an interview, you know, why can't we use tactical nuclear weapons, which is like just vacuous and unthinkable and dangerous in a somebody with actual power.
I think about it as thinking outside the box. But sure.
I live in that box. It's a good box. It's not irradiated yet. But we need these institutions of democratic self-governance when he gives them back, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I wonder what would be accomplished by withdrawal or pure obstructionist, because we've had that under divided government for several years, and it's what's enabled, you know, this history of shutdowns and team first over country or institution or democratic norm or habit of mind. That's what's, to me, set the stage. It's the Republican Party is reaping that harvest now with a sort of white nationalist embodied, you know, Trump presidency, but. You know, the table has been set by
they're reaping the harvest of their 8-year obstructionism with a nominally Republican president, but also with a president they can't control, who does not share their values, who does not share their agenda, who has no agenda of his own, and an electorate that he alone controls and that they have no influence over. So it's a bitter victory for them, even if they feel triumphal in this moment. But
clogging the machine of government does not necessarily, you know, play into people who are trying to use it to help. You know, we need the machine of government. We like the machine of government.
Right.
Well, it's also not possible right now. I mean, the Republicans have a majority in both houses of Congress. So, but I mean, that's another, I'm supporting you. That's another argument against obstructionism, because you know, if the Republicans want to do away with the filibuster, they can do away with the filibuster.
So,
yeah, I mean, yeah.
Yeah, I
agree. The last 48 hours.
I agree with you. The gentleman said, isn't it about keeping the conversation open and not becoming, I'm extrapolating from what you're saying, but you know, not choosing obstructionism as a goal unto itself and a strategy unto itself, while also not normalizing what happened. And I think that there is a delicate way to thread that particular needle.
I mean, yeah, it you know, the Republican Party, the faction of the Republican Party that is offended and opposes Trump, I think has not yet had a reckoning with the racism that it allowed that helped fuel Trump within the Republican Party.
Right.
And that's a difficult, it's, you know, that's a difficult, for me, that's a difficult needle to thread because, you know, I am glad Mitt Romney is taking the stance he is and has against Trump. And I also am aware that he was the person who had Donald Trump during the height of birtherism on stage with him asking for his nomination.
Yeah.
And it is that type of behavior that helped normalize Trump. But I guess I believe that, I believe that there is a way to reach those, that group of people, and that it is going to be better for the country and better for the people living in the country if Elizabeth Warren and Mitt Romney
get married.
Are working together.
Because he can do that. He can have more than one wife. Yes, sir. What's happening?
Just make a note to edit that out before this.
Does that work?
So what is your name?
Leo.
Say again?
Leo.
Leo?
Yeah.
And by the way, Leo was the first to find the microphones in the audience. So, Leo.
There's one. There's another one here.
A bag of mini candy.
All right. I've been toying with a question for the past, feels like a year. And it's whether Trump voters are going to be, and if yes, when, disappointed with Trump and realize that he's not working for them, but working for himself.
Do you have more? Do you have more to say?
No.
Oh, we've been encouraged by the news media to feel empathy for Trump voters.
The fact that you're breaking into that.
Yeah,
right
yeah,
now.
Go for
I
it.
I love that.
And that's a. That's literally a mixed bag.
You don't need to share that. That's all yours. Sorry.
No, that's, I should have taken that opportunity to have some more whiskey then. We've been encouraged by the news media a lot recently, especially. Once we presumed they were all gonna be a bunch of losers and we had to feel sorry for them, to feel empathy for the Trump voter. Even though, almost by definition, the Trump voter was not feeling any empathy for us. The Trump voter was instead fantasizing about electrocuting Hillary Clinton and attacking protesters in their midst. Not all Trump voters. Certainly, I think what we saw that surprised everyone was the amount of silent, quiet Trump voters who did not go to rallies. And just voted for Trump for their own reasons. But it was definitely a part of the Trump campaign to advertise their anger and their desire to strike out at the people that they felt in establishment who had let them down and outside of establishment that they were taking away their opportunities and power. I do feel empathy for the Trump voter, and I never felt it more. I mean, I feel for them because there are people I know who are my neighbors, and I would imagine my family members
in Brooklyn.
Who are, well, yes, but I also, in case you doubted my white privilege, I also have a home in Western Massachusetts.
Right.
And in coastal Maine.
Right.
So, we saw a lot of Trump signs around there, and within, and you know, my both
of my parents' families come from working class backgrounds, whose the fathers worked in manufacturing industries that don't exist anymore, and their wives didn't work at all. It's a world that existed that doesn't exist anymore. And if I were a son or a daughter living in that world and did not have the benefit of my parents moving to Boston, I'd be probably pretty pissed off and confused and desperate as well. Yeah. But, so I have tremendous empathy, but I don't think I've had more empathy than while listening to the victory speech that Donald Trump gave, in which he thanked Hillary Clinton for her campaign and for her service, the public service over many years, and the debt of gratitude that he owed her. And I felt two intense feelings. I was in my car at that moment. I own a car. That's just how incredibly wealthy I am. One was, oh shit, I almost bought it. Like, I was like, oh, he's gonna be fine. He wants to learn from us. Ugh. And then I realized, like, oh no, wait a minute. How can he possibly, how can anyone, you heard what he said 5 days ago. Like, he promised to appoint a special prosecutor to investigate her and hopefully put her in jail. And now he's going, thank you for your service? It's impossible. And in that moment, I was like, there are a bunch of Trump supporters, not all. I think a lot of them were very happy to deal with the cognitive dissonance of knowing that he couldn't build a fucking wall and that he couldn't form a deportation force and he wasn't gonna put Hillary Clinton in jail. But there were a lot of them who sincerely believed that that might happen. And now the betrayal began not even a full 24 hours after he won. Like, he's gonna break a lot of hearts. And I'm gonna fucking enjoy it. But he's also gonna appoint a Supreme Court justice, so that's no good. We're gonna go here. How are you?
I'm good.
Good to see you.
It's good to see you too.
Maybe just angle the mic down a little bit, because it's...
I'm short.
It's like most of America, it's built for tall white men.
Yeah. that wasn't funny.
Actually, it was really funny.
I do want to somehow bring this to comedy.
Sure.
Good luck.
Yeah.
Apparently, you have a different definition of comedy than I do.
This has been very difficult for me, and thank you for being here. I was thinking about lines. We talked about lines that we cross, and I was just remembering when Trump was on Jimmy Fallon and how there was just this very dangerous normalization of this bigot lunatic that we now have to deal with for 4 years. Is there a kind of approach that you believe as a comedian that we, as funny people and as comedians, have to take in order to prevent further normalization of this person? Because I feel that laughter can hide a lot, and I don't want jokes to disguise what this person really is.
Right. So, well, first I would just say I personally agree with the term bigot lunatic, but I would point out that if he is a lunatic, if he is mentally ill, that's not his choice. That's just something that he is. We should be aware of it, and we should maybe be careful about electing him president. But bigot is a choice. Like, he made a choice. And I don't know that he's a bigot. Like, I don't know that he's a racist. I believe that he's a racist in the sense that he believes that there is a human named Donald Trump and then the world is full of something less than humans who are not him, that he has to manipulate in order to please him. But that's, and to me, that would be evidence of sociopathy and mental illness, you know. But he did, I think, make an active choice to court bigotry in this campaign, even if he himself, and even worse, if he himself does not personally feel, I mean, we know he hates women. You know, it's on record that he thinks of women as less than human, right? Like, we can't deny that. But he convinces himself that he doesn't feel that way. Right? He personally doesn't feel that he has racial or animus or misogyny, but
he loves the blacks.
Confused, yeah. No one has more respect for women. That was the craziest. That was like, you are beyond crazy at that point. But he did, there's no question that he made a strategic choice to align with bigotry within the extreme right wing and people who are susceptible to those messages. And I think that that's the part that's sort of unforgivable and why you can't bring him on a show and pet his head like he's some kind of funny uncle, you know. I mean, and for me, it's the thing that always, I remember listening to it in Brookline when I was a teenager on They Might Be Giants Flood, you know, like your racist friend. That song is like, if you have a racist friend, he's not your friend. You know, you can't treat him like a friend. Or the Specials. If you have a racist friend, now is the time for that friendship to end. And I've met Jimmy Fallon. I think he's a very sweet dude. He's a son of Boston. I think he means well, but I think that was a misjudgment on his part. Like, that was not an okay thing to do, you know? How do you deal with it comedically? I mean, I'm not on The Daily Show. And the reason I'm not on The Daily Show, I mean, I loved the show last night, The Daily Show with Trevor Noah. You know, it's the, a part, you know, I love Stephen. Do you need me to get that? Anybody? I think it's utter shame that The Nightly Show was canceled, because I felt that Larry had a really important voice in what was going on this year in the world. But there is no question that The Daily Show is offering, you know, non-white points of view, young non-white points of view and non-male points of view that need to be heard. And both Michelle Wolf and Hassan had incredible pieces last night. And yet I still don't feel that anyone's figured out how to deal comedically with this. I'm not on the Daily Show because my job on The Daily Show was to be a parody of Donald Trump. I mean, in 2011, I suggested a pivot from my sort of generic expert sociopath point of view to specifically deranged millionaire sociopath point of view, because Donald Trump was on CNN and Fox all the time peddling birther nonsense. I was like, we need to have, why is this, you know, millionaire or claimed billionaire allowed to go on news television to spout nonsense all the time? We need to have that character. And also it tied in with the book that I was promoting at the time. but you know, like,
it's a good book.
And so, you know, I did that character, and by the time that Trevor came in 2015, I really didn't want to do it anymore. And in part because I didn't feel that I could come up with comedy that would rival the long-form improv entertainment product that Donald Trump was presenting. Like, there was, comedy is so much about exaggeration, and there is no exaggerating upon him. I consider it my failing. Like, I couldn't figure out how to make fun of that, you know? And I think I'm still, like, you're asking the question. I'm not sure I have the answer. you know, like how to make fun of what's happening. There is a way, we'll find someone who can do it, it's not me. But there is comedy, I think in the best tradition of The Daily Show, which I think continues in its best tradition, where it's both legit funny, but also a critique and also illuminating and not ponderous and dumb. Does that help?
A little. That's enough.
I'm supposed to solve it for you.
Just tweet it when you come up with the full answer.
Okay. I'll let you just
boil it down to 140.
You've had your say, white man, over here.
Yeah.
Hello.
It's 8 o'clock. So are we putting a stop on this?
Yeah, we can. I mean, unless.
Gosh, so sorry. We'll just take two more comments from white men, and then we'll.
Welcome to my life.
We can go for a little while. I mean, we don't.
Okay.
We don't lose the
right. I'm Chris. I'm going nowhere. So.
So one thing that's been occurring to me is we're talking a lot about Trump's presidency, but there is Trump's America. So you're talking about talking to Republicans and bridging that conversation, but how are you going to talk to people who are marginalized? And making sure that you're not just promoting your agenda, but protecting them.
Well, go ahead, Seth.
Well, that's something I've been thinking about a lot also. And I really do believe that that finding some way to be active and be to add yourself to fight against what's going on is both ennobling and can be an effective bulwark against desperation. And so, and what I hope in myself is that I continue to act on the despair that I'm feeling. So I called up the ACLU yesterday and had a conversation with someone there and told them what the areas that I could be potentially helpful in, and essentially said, let's figure out how you can put me to work. I called up the Reporters Committee on Freedom of the Press because I think it's going to be really important to make sure that journalists can continue to report on what's going on safely. And I did this same thing there. I am someone who grew up outside of Boston in not the most racially diverse suburb. And I've tried since I was here to reach out to people who are very different than me. And so last year, one of the communications forums that we did was about how Muslims are being treated at MIT and around the world. And so I called up the people that some of the people that I met through that. That was not my first instinct. My first instinct was to kind of roll up into a ball. And then my second instinct was to figure out how to make sure I was gonna be okay. And I'm gonna be okay. Shit has to really go south before I'm on a cattle car. But I know that's not true for everyone. So I would really support people finding ways that they can be active and use what's going on now. You know, there were times when I was really depressed during the Bush presidency, and I was really depressed, and then I went on and continued to do what I was doing. And I'm sure, like a lot of people, am in huge despair over the fact that I did not do everything I could to make sure that Trump wasn't president. I didn't make calls. You know, when Obama ran, my very elderly grandmother, perhaps not very effectively, berated people on the phone from a call center for hours and hours and hours every week. And to everyone, I think if we can take this moment and make decisions about what we're going to do with our lives, and then not forget that next week when it's not quite so, doesn't feel quite so scary, and the wound isn't quite so fresh. Yeah, but I mean, I'm very aware that one of the things that I need to do is learn from and about and spend time, more time with people who will be more affected than I am, because for me, a lot of this is somewhat notional. Yeah.
I've mostly been tweeting and retweeting. With regard to helping people who are marginalized, my instinct, right or wrong, at this moment is to, and this is about retweeting, is to retweet the testimony of people who are having a being attacked, to listen rather than prescribe, and to be available to the people I know in marginalized and vulnerable communities personally and through the internet, and to help in the way that I'm asked to help. And I feel, yeah, that's, I mean, that's, if there were something more than I could do, I invite you or anyone to encourage me to do it, and I will happily do it. But I don't know that it is helpful for me to tell people how to feel or act at this point. Outside of my community of relatively affluent white dudes, like I'll tell those people, like, get active, you know, press your representatives, don't forget, exactly as Seth said, you know, my mission, I think, is to help and force the people who are in the best position to forget that this is real and meaningful in people's lives, to not forget, and to not just sort of go along as normal, and to keep the wound open and hurting, because there are people who are hurting, and to monitor the people who are hurting, amplify their voices, and offer them help in the way that they need and want and ask to be helped. So that's my answer, for what it's worth. I mean, I don't know if it's the right one.
Hi, my name is Serge. Looking through history, you see, Trump, if he manages to work together with the houses, all the other Republicans in government, who will have more power? The Republican Party will have more power, and him himself as well, than any other president since 1928. And we all know what happened in 1929, you know, the Great Depression.
I don't know.
All right, so I wonder what, you know, Obama was probably surprised this all happened, probably didn't have a plan, I don't know. But in 2 months, what do you think he can accomplish? Hide the nukes, maybe, you know?
Well, go ahead, Seth.
Well, in all seriousness, I mean, he is undertaking efforts to build walls around as much as he can. And there are not a small number of...
Obama or Trump?
Obama.
Okay.
Obama. To build walls around, to put in safeguards in as many ways that he can. And there are lots of Republicans who agree with that. It's possible that if Congress doesn't act...
What is he building walls around? Exactly.
Well, so there are potential safeguards and policies that he can enact involving nuclear weapons before he leaves office, if he has the support of Congress, which he may be able to get. It's possible that if Congress doesn't act, he actually can appoint a Supreme Court, you know, push a sort of constitutional issue and appoint a Supreme Court justice and appoint Garland.
Mm-hmm.
And it's also possible that there are enough Republicans to sort of go along with that. I mean, but from like the tiny, minuscule amount that I know and that people I've talked to, that is the overwhelming preoccupation of what his administration is going
to
do.
Well, let me give you my point of view with no data and having spoken to nobody at all. There's no way Merrick Garland's getting confirmed as a Supreme Court justice before the end of the year, before the end of the Obama administration. Trump will nominate a Supreme Court nominee, and it'll be a fight, but he'll get his person through. And there's no way no one's going to hide the nuclear bombs from him. This is the cost of the election. He's the president. Sorry, I mean, I know that I'm not cynical, and I'm not fatalistic. But it's like,
I'm going to call shenanigans on that first one.
Well, I mean, if the Republican Congress were to move swiftly to confirm Merrick Garland as a Supreme Court justice, there would be a huge outcry among the far right and Breitbart about robbing Donald Trump of his Cthulhu-given right to appoint a Supreme Court nominee. And of course, it's all their fault because they didn't confirm the dude when he was put forward. But it would be a huge public relations disaster that would demonize the Republican Congress. And we know that they are too terrified of bad PR to stand up against the creep who is now their president. They're not going to do it. They'll talk about it. I'm sorry, Seth. I mean, I know you know these people and you're talking to them.
No,
and you actually have insight. But I'm just saying, from where I sit on this side of the stage.
I mean, I think I
would love it, but this is pure grief bargaining.
Republicans were as surprised that Trump got elected as Trump was and as Hillary was. And there were a lot of Republicans who gave a sort of grudging, like, you know, tried to dance on that line or say that they weren't endorsing but were voting for, and who did not think that he had a chance at winning.
But however surprised they were that he got elected, he got elected. And guess what? Republicans are going to get over their surprise. They're going to be like, okay, we're in control now. We're going to do our thing. No way.
I think it's more likely
we'll see what happens.
There's a rift in the Republican Party than that everyone falls in lockstep.
Well, how could there be a rift?
Because there, because
what is your name again, sir?
Oh, I was someone else.
Oh, right.
My name's Chris. Hi.
We gotta go.
What was your name again?
Okay.
Serge, that's right. I knew it was a foreign name. I want my country back, by the way. Serge, I'll leave it to you. Let's meet here again in a year, and we'll see if Merrick Garland is a member of the Supreme Court.
Means we just got two for the price of one with John Hodgman. Everyone, you heard it here first.
Another $800,000. All right, lightning round. Go.
Yeah. My name's Julian. I just want to speak briefly to the comments that young lady just made and to yours about keeping the wound open and feeling that. I just had an interaction today with a friend around my age, privilege. We're talking, you know, was wondering why, and we hear this often, Democrats at lost were being so childish and having protests and unable to, you know, all this grief that was coming from adults on Facebook, you know, with the election. And, you know, I pointed out to him, you're not...
You talk about grief coming from adults on Facebook?
I know. People are sharing.
How old are you?
Interesting. How old am I?
Yeah. What are you talking about, adults on Facebook?
Non-college age people who professional working adults was who my friend was addressing.
Got it.
But I pointed out to him, you're not the homosexual, you know, who's getting beat up, you know, because folks claim, well, Trump's president, this is allowed. You're not someone who's marginalized and feeling uncomfortable in the classroom. You're not the son or daughter of an immigrant that doesn't know if your family's going to be able to stay together. And his response back was, well, that can't be true. You know, those things aren't happening. I haven't seen those things reported, and obviously we all live in our individual bubbles, but that's why...
Even though that's exactly what Trump promised would happen.
Exactly. That's what he advocated for, in a way, and that is what's happening. So that I just want to underscore that to keep that wound open and, publicize when these things happen, because there's a good portion of folks that don't believe these things are happening, and that's part of the outcome of what we've
had. Even if they voted for that to happen.
Exactly, and which this individual did.
But you know what? The other thing about, and I see you're raising your hand. Right. You'll see it happen. Yeah, but a lot of people choose not to see it happening. But I think that here's the hard part. You need to remind people that it's happening. And you also need to appreciate that sometimes they won't believe it. And that's okay. We have a kind of non-functional rule in our household with regard to our children, where we will tell them that they have to do their homework or they have to get dressed, and it was more of an issue when they were younger and prone to throw a tantrum. And they didn't want to do what they had to do. They didn't want to see what they had to see. They didn't want to acknowledge that it was time to turn off the TV or get out of bed and do what they had to do. They didn't want to acknowledge reality. And we would yell and yell and yell, and it wouldn't work. Finally, we realized it doesn't help to yell. And we would say to them, I know you understand the language I'm saying to you. I know you understand the words I'm saying to you. It is time for you to get out of bed and get dressed. I don't mean to infantilize Trump supporters. Maybe a little bit. But there were times when our kids would absolutely continue with the tantrum, but we knew that they heard us, even so. And I think it's the same thing. You keep saying to them, I am human. This is wrong. This is happening. And when they say, that guy disappeared, when they say it's not happening, just say, okay, I'm telling you it's happening. And then over time, I'm confident that they will see that it's happening. It will be up to them to accept it. We can't make them accept it. But we can show it to them, and we'll get some of them, and we'll never get some of them. And that's all we can do. You know, a lot of people have said, we need to reach out to Trump supporters to show them the humanity that we all share. It's not our job. It's their job to wake up to the humanity we all share. We can help them, but we can't bring them there. And I'm not saying this is all Trump supporters. From my point of view, anyone who voted for Trump, if they're not a bigot, is bigot adjacent because they have agreed to a campaign that traded on bigotry. But we can show them the world, and they can either accept it or not. But if we don't show it to them, they'll never get there. That's my point of view. We only have 45 to 59 more minutes.
Can you do a 30-second question?
Yeah. It's actually, I wanted to say thanks for you for being here. I really like your books and your audiobooks. I was thinking of, like, one of the reasons I do is the...
I can only talk about the podcast so many times. Maybe they'll understand, maybe they won't.
You talk about they're absurdities, but they're a lie that holds a greater truth. And one of the things that I get in that is your heart, your humanity that you tell in all these stories, the sadness, the bleakness, the hope. And I kind of almost didn't want to come here tonight because this is a very scary time, and it's a time when many of our hearts are breaking, and I have the privilege of being able to forget that for moments, and I was worried to come here and experience someone else's heart broken or breaking as I knew you would be able to tap in so powerfully. So thank you for being here, and thank you for talking about this in a way that I think gives us something to work with.
Well, it's an awkward time for me to say to you that I am not only a robot, but a hologram. I left this world a long time ago. But thank you. And Yale hat behind you, you have a thing you want to say?
Yeah, super quickly. There's a way that you talk on your podcast, I forget what it's called, but what arts do now, Hiller graphic design, amazing, all forces in entertainment, amazing for Clinton, still, like, comics for Clinton, amazing, art for Clinton, amazing, still, Trump win, no good art for Trump, what art do now?
I honestly did not know what you were doing for a second.
I appreciate that. Did you understand that?
You were talking in a bizarro talk.
Yeah. I was trying to go really fast because I appreciate it.
I was concerned you were having a stroke.
Oh, no.
I assumed
that's really embarrassing.
Like a
Yale,
but like a skull and bones secret language that you two were
me
speaking.
Understand.
You understand? Okay.
What question again?
What is the role of arts now? Because I think we had our best forces. The art that was coming out in favor of Clinton was incredible in this campaign. Like, you mentioned The Daily Show. It was so good. Everything was so good. Like, the entertainment industry was entirely behind her. Her graphic design was made, like, the logo was made by Pentagram. Everything was perfect. Art that I
good
loved.
Good graphic design doesn't solve the world.
Yeah, no, absolutely.
but it does, it's
just
good.
Like, what is the role of, what should the arts do, and what does entertainment have to do now that it's sort of all failed? Because, you know, like so many people
were
for Clinton.
Well, I mean, this is the same thing that, you know, another person asked earlier about, like, Amelia asked, what's comedy supposed to do? I mean, and it's an issue that we all faced after 9/11. When the world broke into before and after. In a very different way, I don't mean to compare them, and people had horrible losses, you know. All we can do is find our way, you know. I think we are all in a moment of processing what this means. Even if we're winning, like even if we were on the other side, we're like, holy shit, now we have this. The thing that struck me was the video of the kids in Royal Oak, Michigan, the middle school, where kids were chanting, build that wall, build that wall, build that wall. And I was tweeting about that, and I was like, what are you gonna do, President Obama, for the kids who are scared in that room? And only in that moment did I realize it's not just the kids who aren't chanting, although I think they deserve our greatest protection. But the kids who are chanting that are also scared because they're being raised in households of hate, you know, and they're processing that as best they can. You know, there's a lot to take in. And I don't think we need to rush as artists to figure out how to process this or make fun of it. Obviously, I'm not entirely comfortable making jokes, even though that's ostensibly my job. Let's take a moment to not make jokes, think about it, talk about it, and then we'll find our bead on it and I hope give people what art has always given, which is a little bit of moral instruction, a little bit of history, and a little bit of distraction, you know, from whatever is behind us as we sit around the fire in the darkness. So
also,
there's no rush to it anyway.
Subscribe to newspapers and magazines also, that's another
thing. That's where Seth and I disagree. The mainstream media has to be brought down.
Rocky Top?
Sure.
Or should I stay or should I go?
Yeah, let's do that
Let's one. Do Rocky Top, because you sing lead on Rocky Top, so.
I'm gonna do a different one, and then we'll do that one.
Okay.
This is
you want to perform without me?
Yeah.
That's fine.
But I'm going to perform with you on that one. Because I don't feel like.
And then we're done. Two songs and then we're done. Stop giving me that look.
I don't feel like. So we rehearsed Rocky Top, which is a song from Tennessee, which is a beautiful state. It went for Trump. And I was thinking about it. It's like I was on a plane with a guy from Chattanooga, Tennessee, where they have the fastest broadband in the United States, because they, as a community, invested in fastest broadband and got it. And this older gentleman, who was very fun to talk to for a while about Maine and Tennessee, where he was from, brought out a bottle of clear liquid that I thought was going to be moonshine. And then it turned out to be water from a lake in Maine that he was bringing to his Rotarian club so they could pray over it for water security. And I realized he does not believe in science. And then he said, Donald Trump is going to save this country. And I was put in a very awkward position of sharing a seat on a plane with a probably 85-year-old man from Tennessee who was never going to be convinced to vote for anyone but Donald Trump. And I felt very sadly in my heart that the only hope that I could have was that he'd die. Before election.
Thanks for coming out, folks.
All right.
I'm not going to sing that Tennessee song. Oh, we got to get out of here.
Yeah, yeah.
All right. So let's just do
Rocket
Top.
Yeah.
Your song. Things fall apart. Everything tends to decay. Oh, shit, I can't remember the song. You know, it takes a lot to combine atoms in such a way that they resist the lure of that darkness that lurks around the edges of every day. So I'm inviting you to join me in this fight, to go down to the river and come up all three times. Hank Williams was right, no one gets out alive. All we have to do is try to have a really good time. Resist the tide, stand in the water, that's baptism, that's making light. Electricity is proof that we can be a little bit of light in all of this darkness. So I'm inviting you to join me in this fight. Rage, rage, rage against the dying of the light. You know you have a voice you can call your own. So just clear your throat and start singing the song. Resist the tide, stand in the water, that's baptism, that's making light. Electricity is proof that there can be light. It takes a lot of work, but oh baby, it's worth it. That song's by Cynthia Hopkins. What are the chords again?
Rocky Top?
Yeah. No, not Rocky Top.
Not Rocky Top?
Yeah.
You're going to sing with me?
Yeah. You're going to do it? You don't want to do Rocky Top?
I want to do Rocky Top. Yeah, yeah. Rocky
Top. Even though I wanted that guy to die?
Well, there's a lot of other good people in Tennessee. We can do, yeah, can end on one. Just just the chorus for Should I Say or Should I Go after that. They're both in D.
Okay, good.
All right.
Okay, so very quickly, this is a song from Eastern Tennessee called Rocky Top. It's a song founded on nostalgia, which is the most toxic impulse. It is exactly what Trump has been promising his followers, that the past was better. We know it wasn't. And that it is, we can travel back in time to it, which we can't. This song is a profoundly nostalgic song, but it's still pretty good.
It's a pretty great song.
Wish that I was on old Rocky Top, down in the Tennessee hills. Ain't no smoggy smoke on Rocky Top, ain't no telephone bills.
So all right, so this is describing a utopia on top of a hill in eastern Tennessee where there are no telephone bills, which is the greatest thing, apparently.
Once had a girl up on old Rocky Top, half bear the other half cat.
That's also a utopia, apparently.
Wild as a mink, but sweet as soda pop. I still dream about that.
All right, so it's already dehumanizing women, and
we should have gone over this beforehand.
Yeah, it's a virgin and whore dynamic. One part mink, one part soda pop. I still dream about that. You just
grab
her pussy.
Half cat.
Right, yeah, right over.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, yeah. It was wild as a mink.
Wild as a mink, right.
Rocky Top, there'll always be home sweet home to me.
Whoa, sorry, let's do the chorus again. Rocky Top, you'll always be home sweet home to me.
Good old Rocky Top. Rocky Top, Tennessee. Rocky Top, Tennessee.
Once two strangers climbed. You can't stop singing now.
Oh, yeah.
First of all, for moonshine
has everyone noticed that Seth Manukin plays the mandolin? Round of applause for that. All right, here we go. One, boo, boo, boo.
Once two strangers went up a Rocky Top looking for a moonshine too. Strangers never come down from Rocky Top. Reckon they never will.
They were murdered.
Up on old Rocky Top grounds, too rocky by far. That's why all the folks on Rocky Top get their corn from a jar.
That's bourbon.
Rocky Top, you'll always be home sweet home to me. Good old Rocky Top. Rocky Top, Tennessee. Rocky Top, Tennessee.
Third verse.
Worst lyrics in music.
I've had years of cramped up city life, trapped like a duck in a pen. All I know is it's a pity life can't be simple again. Rocky Top, you'll always be home sweet home to me. Good old Rocky Top, Rocky Top, Tennessee, Rocky Top, Tennessee.
Where is it? Darling, you've got to let me. Everyone has to sing this.
Because it's the question on everyone's minds.
Yeah, this was prompted by someone with dual, with a Finnish
with dual
wife,
citizenship.
A Finnish
Icelandic
wife,
citizenship.
American husband.
Half and half.
It's you two.
I'm American, she's
it's you two, but you have the weird name.
Yeah.
No. You do. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So
Peter,
she's Icelandic.
Slime.
No, she's Icelandic.
That's what I just said.
Sorry.
You seem destined to confuse me. You
but your last name,
name
is like, is Peter Slime or something.
Palmer-Shine.
Yeah.
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 Mm.
And
yeah.
And also you talk like this.
And that's coming from
so
someone.
So your question was, should you stay or should you go to Iceland? And what is your feeling right now?
Well, we still have our lease, so we're going to stay for
a little while. That's an important criteria for
where in Iceland are you from? That's where everyone's from, Reykjavik, right? No other humans live elsewhere in Reykjavik.
Do you have room for us?
Yeah, of
course. Not just us, all right. All right.
All right, when does your lease end?
July.
In July? Well, you'll know by then.
What's A7? We're not doing that anyway.
What are we not doing?
The A7.
So you gotta let me know.
Okay, we're starting the song. We just learned it. And we've never met before.
Yes, yeah. Neither of us have ever known it, but let's just do the first verse-ish. Let's do it until they stop singing. Darling, you've got to let me know. Should I stay or should I go? If you say you are mine, I'll be here till the end of time. No, no, no. So you gotta let me know. Should I stay or should I go? We finished.
No, no. Next verse. Next verse. Keep going. No, no. Come on. Come on.
It's always tease, tease, tease. Happy when I'm on my knees. I forgot to know it's fine and next is black. We should have switched to G. Come on and let me know. Should I stay or should I go?
Big finish.
Should I stay or should I go now? Should I stay or should I go now? I say it will be double. So come on and let me know. Should I stay or should I go?
I think we all need to go.
Yes.
Seth Mnookin, ladies and gentlemen.
Judge John Hodgman. Thank you all so much for coming out. Please. Stay involved, support your community, and support each other, and also sign up for our mailing list, and we will see you all down the line. Thank you.